Good evening, brothers and sisters in Christ. Happy Sabbath. There are 33 verses in the Bible talking about eagles. Okay, it's a very prominent creature in the Bible, and God himself has compared himself to that of an eagle carrying the children of Israel and protecting them. There are 33 verses. I'm not going to mention all those 33 verses. I'm going to focus on only one verse, but that is going to be towards the end. Before that, let's understand what eagles are like. I know some of you already know. Eagles are huge, magnificent birds. They are a symbol of freedom, power, and strength. And these birds, they fly so high. They have very powerful vision, 3 times the human vision. Okay? And they have, maybe I should change the mic. They have these huge wings. Okay, the wingspan, when they stretch their wings from one tip to the other tip, it's about 2.3 meters. Okay, and they have this hooked beak. And they have very powerful talons. On each leg, there are 4 toes, and these talons, they're very powerful. They're capable of carrying 3 to 4 pounds of weight. You must have heard stories about eagles carrying the babies away, the little deers and the lambs. You know, that's strong they are. They're so powerful, strong, magnificent birds. They are a symbol of strength. You know, this powerful bird goes through a process of change. You know, when the bird is around 30 years old, it goes through a very, very low point in its life. The wings of this bird over the years have collected a lot of dust. The oil secretions in the wings had accumulated all the dust, and the wings are beginning to stick on the skin of the bird. As I said, these birds, they fly so high, they can even swoop down and catch fish and its prey. Now it's getting so heavier that it cannot move its wings up and down. And now it's getting difficult for the bird to catch its prey. It cannot go high up when the strong winds blow. It's getting difficult. Now there is only one choice for this bird right now, whether the bird would remain as it is and struggle with this or go through a process of change. They say eagles can live up to 70 years, but at 30 years it has to make a very difficult choice. Now, there is a process called molting. All the birds go through this process. They shed their feathers. Now eagles, they have to go through a very difficult process that lasts for about 5 months. So when the wings are getting heavier and their beaks are getting callous, they're no more sharp and hooked, but they're getting blunt, calloused. The talons are getting calloused. So it's very difficult for them to catch its prey and fly high and tear the flesh. Now it is a matter of survival. Now what's happening? It has to make this difficult choice. Whether the bird would stay like that and struggle and die, or go through the process of change. The process of change is molting. Molting is the bird has to voluntarily pick all the feathers. There are thousands of feathers on eagles. There are small, small feathers like our hair, so closely embedded. And there are huge feathers. And now it has to pick every single hair and the feather out. and it's a very, very painful process. And now it's exposed to the vulnerability of the surroundings. Okay, now let's see what happens. The first step is the calloused beak. Now it has to hit against the hard surface and break. So it hits and hits and the beak breaks. And then it waits for the new beak to form. And then it picks up the talons, it tears up those callous talons. And it waits for them to grow. In the process, as they grow, now it picks up its own hair one by one, the feathers one by one. And now it's naked. It's exposed to all the creepy, crawly creatures around. Now it cannot fly anymore, catch its prey. Now there are other birds who can pick on the naked eagle. And it is going through a very painful process, a very tough one for its survival. It can even die in the process. And there are these other matured eagles who drop some food time to time so that it can feed. There is a verse in the Bible. Okay, we're going to talk about two verses. There's a verse in the Bible that talks about eagles in Micah 1:16. Make yourself bald and cut off your hair because of the children of your delight. Extend your baldness like the eagle, for they will go from you into exile. Says, cutting the hair or shaving is an expression of mourning and grieving. When the children of Israel are in captivity, this is what the prophet Micah has written. You expose, okay, your nakedness, like shaving off your head, like that of an eagle. This is talking about molting, and I believe molting is real because it's in the Bible mentioned here. As I said, this process is about for 5 months, 150 days, and it is a matter of its survival. So one of the commentary says that when she molts her feathers, for they are gone into captivity, the prophet is saying calamity would be so great as to deserve the strongest expression of grief. You know, this is one of the hardest things that eagle goes through, and it has to go through this for its survival. You know, let's compare our lives to that molting process. The eagle is exposed, it's naked, no feathers, exposed to all these creepy crawling things. You know why it has to go through this process of change? Some of us right now, we all go through these negative emotions, and we cover up all this with what the world offers us. We cover up with this insecurity, whatever that we're going through, with our achievements or talents or with whatever titles that we can have, and we say we are fine. But deep down within, something that happened several years ago when you're a child, or something that happened over the years, is still bothering you and me. Let's take time. This is our time with you and the Lord, a very personal time. Let's look at the screen. Let's identify what is that feather that is sticking on you still that you need to pluck off. Expose your nakedness in the sight of the Lord. What is that? What is that that is bothering you? It may be one, it may be two. You don't have to tell anyone. It's between you and the Lord. Identify it. Identify that negative thing that you're going through right now. Is it depression? Is it doubt? Is it despair, shame, sadness, fear, frustration, guilt, envy, grief, jealousy? Identify what is making you heavy that's preventing you to fly so high against the storms. Okay, let's expose this to God. Because God is inviting, you don't have to carry this heavy load on you. You don't have to carry this heaviness on your feathers. This, as long as you're going to carry, you're going to swoop down like this, and you're not going to be as strong as you're meant to be. And God is inviting us, come unto me, all that you are labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Let's come out of this valley of unbelief, God is inviting us, I will give you rest. You know, that's what it is, molting process for the 5 months, for the bird, is a process of renewal, a process of very difficult change for it to be renewed. So much so, this is a very painful process for us also to go through this negative emotions, that we need to break this bondage. What is that chain that is holding on to you right now, that is keeping you in captivity? Let's self-examine. We have to break this with power, with fasting and prayer. Only the power of Jesus can do this in our lives. The burden must be very heavy upon you right now. Is there anybody? You don't have to say to anyone, it's between you and the Lord. What is that that is pressing you? And nobody can see you, what you're going through. It's only you who are suffering. And nobody can understand you. What is that heavy burden that is robbing all your joy? You have everything and still you're not happy. What is that pressing down, pressing you so down, that is making you feel so unhappy? God says, Jesus says, come unto me. Just give it to me. Just give it to me and he will take it. All we have to do is just release. Let's take this moment to understand what God has done for us. You may be thinking, wow, I have done this. I'm feeling so heavy. I have to bear this because I know I have done this. It is my fault. But God has sent his only son. 2,000 years ago, Jesus paid it all. You don't have to carry this anymore. He paid everything on the cross for you and me. He already paid the price for those heavy sins. You and I don't have to carry that anymore. All he's asking you is to claim the blood of Jesus and say, Lord, your blood is powerful. In your name, I release this. Release me from this bondage. Claim the power and the anointing of the power of the blood and the Holy Spirit. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Is there anybody condemning you today for what you have done 30 years ago? Are they still telling you, when you were a child, you did this, remember? When you were a teenager, you did that, remember? And now you talk like a saint. Is anybody condemning you right now? God has not come here to condemn anyone. God has not asking anyone to condemn anyone. In fact, he said, I have borne all sins. I have taken everything upon me. No one has any right to condemn my son, my daughter, because they are my children. I have purchased them with my precious blood. My royal blood is flowing through them. And they are my sons, my daughters. You have no right to condemn anyone. Come to Jesus. Claim his blood. Claim his forgiveness. Just repent. Give it all to him. God says, I have come here so that you can enjoy this abundant life. Let's read this verse, John 10:10. I came so that you may have life and life and live it more abundantly in Jesus. Jesus has come so that we can have an abundant life. That's why he died for us. He bore all the penalty for us on our behalf. We don't have to bear this burden anymore. Let's come to the feet of Jesus. Let's kneel down. Let's take this time between you and the Lord. Let's sing this song. Maybe can we go down on our knees? I curse all my care upon you. Time. have sent your son Jesus to die on the cross, bearing all our guilt, our shame, our unworthiness, our sins. Every sin has been paid on the cross through the blood of Jesus Christ, your son. And we claim ourselves and daughters and sons because you have purchased us through your son's blood. So Lord, we kneel in your presence right now, identifying the negative thing that is weighing us down. We release this at your feet, knowing that you alone have the power to free us from this bondage. So Lord, we cast everything at your feet right now, Lord. The nail-pierced feet. Lord, people have bone nails in the feet of Jesus. The blood bruised for my sins and for everybody's sin. The precious child, precious son, precious daughter who is right now, Lord. He's suffering with the bondage. Satan is very happy to make everybody feel that we are under captivity. But Lord, you have made us free long ago. 2,000 years ago, we are free in Jesus, Lord, by what Jesus has done. So Lord, we cast everything at your feet right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So after 5 months of molting, this is what the eagle looks like. The callous beak is replaced with a new beak. A hook, very new. It looks new. The old hair is replaced with new hair. The old feathers were plucked off. It's replaced with new feathers. It has this new youthful look. This is our promise in Isaiah 40:31. Yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not become weary. This is a process we all go through when we wait on the Lord. Waiting on the Lord, acknowledging our negative thing, laying the burdens at his feet, going through this process of change in prayer and fasting, singing praises to the Lord, claiming his promises. Every promise in this Scripture is for us and for all of us, for everyone who claims to be the son and daughter of God. Every promise is true. It's for you and me. Claim every promise in the name of Jesus and say, Lord, this promise is in this Bible for me. I want this to be fulfilled in my life in the name of Jesus. And you fast and pray for that. What is that weighing you today? Kneel at the cross. Lay everything at his burden. Release it in the name of Jesus. Go through this fasting and prayer in your personal life, not necessarily only in this organized way, but even in your personal life. Every week, at least one meal, you can do this for your spiritual life. Go into the fields, into an open area where there is freshness and greenery. Talk to God. Release everything. Release everything. You don't have to go tell anybody, because they will cheat you in the end. They will carry all the tales and you will get into trouble later. Just release everything. Talk to the Lord at his feet. Have a personal experience with him. And the appearance of the eagle is that of a young eagle, the youthful look. And after the period of fasting and prayer, after waiting on the Lord, God will bestow upon you and me the strength like of a young person who is ready to run a marathon. If you are depressed, sad, something is putting you down, you're heavily burdened, just go cry it out. Lay at God's feet.
Many of you have two challenges with personal relationship, interpersonal. I don't worry what your challenges are. Let's kneel down right now. Let's talk to God. This is your moment. Jesus says, he that cometh to me in no wise will I cast him. Jesus will never cast you. If you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? My dear young people, will you please ask God right now to fill you with the Holy Spirit? Please keep talking to God. Lord, I prioritize the sweet Holy Spirit. Lord, I long to be full with your Holy Spirit. Lord, I desire, I pursue, I earn and I long and I compel to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Lord, many times I have cherished another spirit. I have cherished the spirit of self-sufficiency, self-reliance, self-dependence. Lord, I've been proud. I've been arrogant. I've been rude. I've been rebellious. Young people, there is nothing like being transparent with God in the holy presence of a dedicated altar. The presence of God is here, and He wants you to be dead honest with God and with yourself. His eyes are more powerful than laser. He can perform a micro laser surgery from heaven. God is telling you, I know your works. You have left your first love. My son, my daughter, you don't read your Bible like how you used to read 1 year ago. You don't talk to me. You have enough time to chat on the Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter. God is convicting all of us. Why have you not talked to me? God is telling you, I need to talk to you, but you don't set aside some time for me. I want to talk to you, my son. My son, I love you. I long to be with you. But you left your first love. You've fallen from grace. It's never too late to come to God. Never too late to come to God. Some of us have time to text, to be on WhatsApp, to always Skype with our beloveds. Have you faced God today? Before you came to this fasting and prayer, did you spend time on your knees? Today, God is not interested in your formal prayer here. No, He wants to tell you, my son, I love you. Turn back to God right now. My daughter, I've been longing to spend time with you, but you never give me a chance. Today, I want you to have a U-turn. From today, you're going to bask yourself in the presence of God. He who is not with me is against me. You have not been against God, but you have not been with God. And that's enough. Without me, you can do nothing. and you've been trying to do everything without me. But I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I want you to tell God, Lord, I have a crisis. Lord, my heart is broken. I am so severely wounded. Lord, I am at the point of breakdown. Lord, I am psychologically depressed. I have given up mentally. I can't tell even my best friend. And I'm ashamed to share this in the public. Why have you let me down, God? My Father, why have you forsaken? Cry to God. God wants to set things right with you. It's because you've gone astray. Behold, the Lord's hand is not short that it cannot save, but our iniquities have separated one moment with God. One moment with God and turn around your life. God does not want your GPA. He does not want your degree. He does not want your academic excellence. He wants you. He wants your heart. He wants your soul. He wants your life. And He longs to touch you right now. Your life will never be the same if you make a simple surrender. All to Jesus, I surrender. Lord, I love my girlfriend more than you. Lord, I love my boyfriend more than you. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, that all these things shall be added unto you. God will never subtract. He's not a liar. God will add, God will multiply. If something is being subtracted, I have not prioritized God and His kingdom. From tonight, young people, your lives will never be this. He fed millions of people for 40 years. Do you think He cannot give you a breakfast noodles? Do you think He cannot put a cup of rice and some wine? It's not about Him. It's about me. Lord, I repent today. I have been proud. I have been against you. I did not even read my Bible for many weeks. I've not prayed to you like how I used to. Today I repent of my pride. Today I repent of my rebellion. Lord, I am tired of my life. I cannot move on. I am I've almost come to the point of no return. Thank you for this prayer meeting. Thank you for this fasting and prayer. Prayer doesn't save me. Fasting doesn't save me. Jesus is saving me. Lord, I pray as I humble myself, touch these young people. Touch these students. They don't need just education. They need life eternal and abundant life. Today, in Jesus' name, we cast away every evil spirit that's trying to bind them. Lord, do not allow the evil one to bind them. We want to cast away the evil spirit of financial crisis. In Jesus' name, liberate them, Lord. Perform a miracle. Provide finance for them. You can do it, Lord. The cattle and the thousand hill belongs to you. Silver is mine, gold is mine, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory. Lord, some of us need emotional, personal healing. We are going through so much of hurt. My best friend has betrayed me. My relatives hurt me. My parents scolded me. My teachers gave up on me. My best buddies irritated me. There is so much of peer pressure I cannot handle. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we release the power from the throne of grace. Young people, be anointed with the power, the fire, the rain of the Holy Ghost. Be filled with Jesus from the crown of the head to the sole of your foot. The devil doesn't possess you anymore. He is fleeing in Jesus' name. Your lives have been painted by the blood of Jesus. Lord, I want to pray for physical healing. If there is someone here who is afraid of the physical illness or challenge, release them, Lord. One touch. If you can raise a dead man, what about resurrecting and renewing these young people? Father, will you please touch them? Touch every cell and tissue and muscle and organ and fiber and ligament and tendon. Let every organ receive fresh anointing from the throne of grace. Let the blood flow from Jesus' cross and his body to them. I want to pray for their relationship with their parents. Just in case if they are hurt and hurting, heal them. If they are having issues with their relationship, remove that, Lord, right now, and may Jesus be the darling of their lives. Jesus is the rose of Sharon. May he be the lily of the valley. Lord, I want to pray that you breathe your peace. May these young people receive healing in Jesus' name. Prosper their lives. Write their names in the book of life. Lord, let them first be saved and then let them be educated. Please take away the stony heart. Give them a heart of flesh. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God has touched every one of you, and your lives will never be the same. God bless. God bless. God be the glory.
We would like to teach you one more scripture song found in Psalm chapter 143, verse 8. So please turn with me to the book of Psalms, chapter 143. So we'll sing it for you once, and then we'll teach it to you. It's a very simple song. like an echo. So come sweet city of the Lord, thy loving kindness in the morning, for in thee do I trust, in thee do I trust, cause thee to know the way wherein I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. Psalm 143 verse 8. So let's try it all together. We'll sing it line by line. So cause me to hear, ready? Cause me to hear, thy loving kindness in the morning. Again? Cause me to hear, thy loving kindness in the morning. For in thee do I trust, in thee do I trust. For in thee do I trust, again? For in thee do I trust, in thee do I trust. Same tune. Cause me to know the way wherein I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. Psalm 143 verse 8. The second half of the song begins. Cause me to know, ready, sing. Cause me to know the way wherein I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. Where is it now? Psalm 143 verse 8. So did you guys get it? We'll sing it all together one last time. Cause me to hear, ready, sit. Cause me to hear, thy loving kindness in the morning. For in thee do I trust, in thee do I trust. Cause me to know the way wherein I should walk.
Let us pray as we begin. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you. It has been a grand experience. You have pointed out our pride. You've nailed down the sin in our heart. And have shown unto us that we are not worthy of any good thing. You have shown us the blackness of sin. And have revealed that unless we turn away, we will not experience them. And so, dear God, we come, knocking on your door, pleading with you, that as we close this Sabbath journey, as we close this experience of the blessing, the power, the majesty, that it may not end tonight, God, but that we may continue to live in the light of Jesus Christ. Father, some serious changes have to be made in order for us to experience that peace that passes all understanding. And so I pray, Lord, your people need to be set free tonight. We plead in the name of Jesus. that as you have pointed out our sins, may you now teach us also how to come back to the arms of Jesus. Teach us, O God. Teach us. Discipline us. Remove any distraction that would keep us from being taught by the Holy Spirit. That before this night ends, may we find ourselves safely in the bosom of Jesus Christ. This is my prayer, Lord. May you cast this manservant asunder and allow your people only to see Jesus. And Jesus alone we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I request you to turn to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 7. Let us turn our Bibles there to look at an interesting experience in the history of Israel. 1 Samuel chapter 7, are you all there? The Bible says, the men of Kirjath-Jearim came and fetched up the ark of the Lord. See, the Philistines had stolen the ark away from Israel. And it was solely because of Israel's pride and Israel's thought that they had all things down and under. It was because of Israel's thoughts and sins that had led them to go into captivity, into sin, and into the bondage of evil. It came to a point that they had begun to use the holy sacraments of God to begin to think that the mere sacraments would bring them victory from evil powers. It was a time when they were busy disobeying God, but when they went into war, they said, no, if only we have the Ark of God, which represents the presence of God, the Ark on which God's glory came and rested, if only we have the Ark, the enemies cannot touch us. They were disobeying God, had raised up other little gods and idols in their homes. But they said, as long as we can carry the Ark of God, we will be safe. So in one battlefield in the Philistines, they carry the Ark of God onto the battlefield. And the priests and Eli's sons who are carrying the Ark, they get killed. And the Ark is stolen. Eli, as he hears the news, he dies. And a series of things happen simply because people put their faith in things while completely disobeying God. Many people have put faithful tithes while they are faithfully disobeying God. Are you listening to me? They've never been unfaithful with tithes, but they've been very faithful in disobeying God's commands. And they claim, Lord, I have paid tithe, I demand a blessing. Why I disobey you openly. Let's take the Ark of God, because it's the presence of God. How is the presence of God there when I've been disobeying Him with all my heart, mind, and soul? This is like a little child saying, Mommy and Daddy, keep a Bible next to my bed. If I have a Bible next to my bed, the devil will not disturb me. Because as if all of heaven is encapsulated here, and if only the Bible is next to my pillow, I will never be afraid. The Ark is stolen. Finally, the men of Kirjath-Jearim, they came and they fetched up the Ark, or they're taking it away from the Philistines. Pay attention in verse 1. 1 Samuel 7 verse 1, they take it away from the Philistines, they fetch up the Ark of the Lord, and now notice this, they brought it into the house of Abinadab in the where? In the where? The Ark is now coming closer to God's people. Is that a good news? But notice that the Ark is coming closer, but they come and put the Ark in the house of Abinadab. Where does Abinadab stay? On a hilltop. Are you following the story? The Ark is getting closer. People are happy, okay, the Ark is somehow getting closer, but the Ark is now stuck on a hilltop. And it's not just been a day or a few months. Notice what verse 2 says. It came to pass while the ark abode in Kirjath-Jearim that the time was long. How long was it? For 20 years. For 20 years the ark came and rested, and they brought the presence of God, but the ark was still on a hilltop. The ark was still there on hilltop, but Israel, notice in verse 2, it ends by saying, and all the house of Israel lamented after the Lord. All of Israel was crying and mourning. This is one of the very few moments in the history of Israel that they had all come together in crying before the Lord. 1 Samuel 7 is an amazing chapter. All of Israel has gathered together. They are united in pleading for their sins. The Bible says they cried after the Lord. Now notice this. If the ark is in hilltop, then what's the problem? Are you listening to me? But we thought God's presence has to be felt in our churches. But if the ark is already on a hilltop, why is Israel still crying? Because the ark was only as far as hilltop, but it never went home with them. Are you there? And so many will look past, after a few weeks or a few months around, they look past to this prayer and fasting as a hilltop experience. We experience God's glory in a hilltop, but why did God's glory remain on a hilltop for 20 years and never entered your home? Are you still there?
Yes.
Why is it that I've enjoyed messages and Bibles? And I love praying when I'm in church, but when I go home, I'm not carrying God's glory back to my home. There's a struggle there. What is this? Verse 2 says, all of Israel was lamenting. They were mourning. They were crying before the Lord. When was the last time you mourned because God's presence was not felt in your life? When was the last time you cried and wept and your knees were swollen because you would not get up from your knees because you did not see and experience and feel God's presence in your life? Israel was crying and mourning, Lord, we want your presence. Our life. This is strange and has happened very few times. And the Bible tells us this is a rare manifestation. Go with me to the book of Habakkuk. We'll see something similar to this. The book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk is in conversation with God. You've got to see this. Somebody here is asking the question, Lord, I feel your presence is not there. Lord, I've been walking away from you many times. Lord, I've not been drawing close to you. I've not been studying my Bible. I've not been praying. Maybe this is the first time I've prayed and fasted. Maybe this is the first time someone has emphasized the tithing to me, Lord. I want to know, Lord, why is it that when you are missing in my life, I don't have this kind of response? Why is it that I don't respond like this to your absence? Why is it that I'm not mourning and crying? You're with me in the book of Habakkuk. Are you there? Go to chapter 3. Habakkuk is talking to God. In conversation with God, notice what Habakkuk says as he hears God speaking to him. Habakkuk 3 verse 16. Habakkuk 3:16. When I heard, Habakkuk speaking, pay attention. When I heard, my belly trembled. Habakkuk 3:16. My lips quivered at the voice. He says, Lord, when I heard you speaking to me, when I felt I was in your presence, my belly began to tremble. My lips were shaking. He goes on to say, Lord, there was rottenness that entered into my bones. Lord, I felt like my bones have no strength. They're dead. Lord, I felt rottenness in my bones and I trembled in myself. When was the last time you felt this? When you came to church to worship. When was the last time this was your response? When you knelt by your bedside and prayed, Lord, I'm in your presence. My belly is trembling. My lips are quivering. But I feel like there's no strength left in my bones. I'm in the presence of a holy God. Go to Isaiah 6. Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah, the man of God, preaching the word of God to a nation that has gone away from God. Isaiah from chapter 1 all the way through 5 is doing a magnificent job at taking the words of God and presenting it to a nation that has turned its back upon God. Go with me to Isaiah 6 as you see Isaiah's response. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1. Hard-ended preaching. Spirit-filled preaching up until chapter 5. And now notice Isaiah himself in chapter 6. Isaiah 6 verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up. His train filled the temple. Notice we're taking a look at a few of these patriarchs. We're taking a look at Habakkuk. We just noticed he's in God's presence. He says, Lord, my belly is trembling. My lips are quivering. I feel like my bones are dead and rotten. We're now looking at Isaiah, the man of God, just as Habakkuk. But notice in Isaiah 6 verse 1, he says, I saw the Lord sitting on his throne. He's given a rare insight, a rare view that very few humans have had. It is the throne room of God. He sees the Lord sitting on his throne, high and lifted up. Verse 2, he saw seraphims. Each one had 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their face. With 2 wings they covered their feet. With 2 wings they flew. Verse 3, they cried one to another saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Verse 4 tells us that the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Isaiah, full, empowered preaching, all up until chapter 5. Chapter 6 takes a strange turn, and Isaiah is shown the throne of God, angels surrounding the throne of God. And immediately as Isaiah comes this close to God, notice his words in verse 5. Then said I, Isaiah speaking, that man of God who we talk about, Isaiah said, woe is me, I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. What's happening here? When Habakkuk is in God's presence, he says, Lord, my belly is trembling, my lips are quivering. Isaiah, when he stands so close to God, he begins to say, Lord, woe is unto me, for I'm undone. But these are not unholy people, are you there? These are not wicked and ungodly people. These are men of God who are speaking like this. My last example, go to the book of Job. The book of Job. Job chapter 40. The man who we talk about, the oldest book in the Bible. Job chapter 40. The man of faith, the man of courage, the man of power. The man of unshakable, unwavering trust in God. That man, Job, notice, Job chapter 40, 4-0. Job chapter 40 and verse 4. The words of Job. Job 40 and verse 4. Verse 3 says, Job answered the Lord and said, Lord, behold, I am vile. What shall I answer thee? I will lay mine hand upon my mouth. Now, Israel was lamenting and crying and mourning. We want God's presence. They felt the desperation. God was absent and they were crying and mourning. We want God back in our life. Habakkuk is in God's presence. Lord, my belly is trembling, my lips are quivering. Isaiah is saying, Lord, woe is unto me. I'm undone. I have unclean lips. Job is saying, I'm not worthy to say anything, Lord. I will cover my mouth. Why are these people responding this way? And why is it that this is not my response many times in worship? Am I talking to someone? Why is it that when I come to worship, I don't say this? Why is it that when I come to worship, I feel like I can say whatever I want from my mouth? Why is it that when I come to worship, I feel like I'm great and I'm mighty and I'm holy and I'm a great person. And I don't feel like woe is unto me, I'm undone. A man of unfaithfulness. Thanks. If you pay attention to all these three patriarchs, Job, Isaiah, Habakkuk, they did not respond the way they responded until they got this close to God. When Habakkuk heard God speak to him, he responded this way. When Isaiah saw God on his throne, he responded that way. When Job heard God talk to him, he said, Lord, I'm not worthy. I'm here to let us know the reason why many times we don't feel that desperation. We don't sense that brokenness. We don't feel that unworthiness is because we're still far, far, far away from God. And the Bible tells us, until you come that close to God as Isaiah was standing before God's throne, until you stand like Habakkuk listening to the voice of God, until you like Job would stand in faith, you will never see the ugliness of sin within you. So I feel holy. I feel great. I feel like I'm a mighty person. But you'll never know how deep the darkness of sin within you is until you stand intimately close and close and closer to God. There are things I did a year ago I can't believe I did a year ago. Is there someone here who can create a list right now in your head and say, there are stuff I used to do last year, I can't believe I did that. I could never do that this year. God abhors something like that. Can you create a list like that? And the thing is, the longer you stay in God, that list has to keep getting longer. Are you still listening? Because the truth is, the further you are from God, the less convicted you feel in your heart. And then the truth is, many times our churches are filled with Pilate. You remember Pilate from the Bible? And while we look upon him, he washed his hands, he did not care, he could have saved Jesus. We say all that stuff about him. But the truth is, many a times there's a Pilate hidden in my heart. There's a Pilate hidden in my heart. Why Pilate was convicted that this is the man of God. The wife told him, have nothing to do with this man. This is a man of God. Pilate was deeply convicted in his heart that I should not touch Jesus. He's a man of God. But Pilate, like almost all of us, was convicted but not converted. Deep conviction. Many sit here. I have to pay my tithe. Tonight itself, I'm convicted. I have to pay my tithe. And you go home and sleep. You don't pay your tithe. Convicted, but not converted. Praying and fasting. I know this was missing. I have to start this ministry in my own life. I don't have to necessarily come to church on a Sabbath to pray and fast. I can do this during the week. I can pray. I'm convicted that I've got to do this and come this week. You forget what it means to pray and fast. Convicted, but not converted. And the Lord says, until you draw this close to me, as these patriarchs were, you will never know how ugly your sin is. You'll still keep feeling holy and self-righteous and self-confident and self-dependent. It is not until you get in the express presence of God, that intimate dream, that you'll say, Lord, I feel like I have no strength. I feel like my bones are rotten. I don't have anything, Lord, in your presence. That's the experience the Lord wants us to have. Now notice this. Samuel, in 1 Samuel 7, penning down this powerful story of the experience of Israel, writing about what Israel is going through. 1 Samuel 7, let's go back to that story to see what the Lord has for us. 1 Samuel chapter 7. 1 Samuel 7 tells us, in verse 2, Israel was lamenting after the Lord. Verse 3, Samuel spake. 1 Samuel 7, verse 3. Samuel spake to the house of Israel, saying, if you do return unto the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the strange gods and Ashtaroth from among you. If you do want to turn away and come to God, then put away the strange gods and turn to the Lord with all your heart. We want to draw closer. Lord, we want to have that same experience as Isaiah, as Habakkuk, as Job. But Lord, I'm not having that experience. I crave that experience, but I'm not having them. Samuel gives us a reason. He says, you'll never experience that intimacy until you're willing to let go of that one little thing that blocks your way. Are you listening? It doesn't have to be a multitude of sins. No, no, no. It has to be that one little thing that's hiding somewhere in your heart. Sister White tells us that one sin cherished long enough, one sin cherished long enough can destroy the whole gospel in your life. Just one little sin. He says, if you really want to experience that intimacy, you can read the Bible all you want. Friends, you've got to listen to me. You can read the Bible all you want. You can come for prayer and fasting again and again till Jesus comes. But until you take that sin out of your life, until you take that foreign God out of your life, you will never experience the peace that passes all understanding. It's got to go if you want to experience what Isaiah, Habakkuk, Haggai, Job, and others experience. It's got to go. What do? Turn your Bibles to Psalm 119. Psalm 119 is called the Psalm of the Word of God. Psalm 119, if you have your Bibles, are you all there? Can you hold up your Bibles if you have Psalm 119? Can you hold up your Bibles? Can you open Psalm 119 and hold it up? Okay. If you have Psalm 119 and you're opening up your Bible there, do you know that you're in the middle of the Bible? That's the midsection of the Bible. From Psalm 119, you can divide the Bible equally. Are you there? It's the midsection of the Bible. And the midsection of the Bible is emphasizing to you the power of the Word of God. What is it emphasizing? The power of the Word of God. Now, we've got to appreciate that power tonight if we want to come back to God, put away all evil, and come and know God very deeply and very intimately. Psalm 119 is divided, it is, of course, as you know, the longest chapter in the Bible. It is divided into 22 sections. How many?
23.
There are 22 different sections. If you have your Bible, you'll see them divided into 22 sections, or 22 paragraphs, if you'd like to call them. And at the top of each paragraph, you will see a Hebrew word, which is the name of a Hebrew alphabet. So starting, say, from A all the way to Z, the psalmist wrote a collection of material inspired by the Spirit, starting with that very alphabet. Are you following it through? So he started the first alphabet, and he wrote a prose starting from letter A. Then he went to B, and he wrote a whole collection of words starting from the alphabet B. And he went like this through all the 22 alphabets in the Hebrew language. Now, as he does this throughout the chapter, it's an amazing study to do. All of Psalm 119 is emphasizing one thing, and that is that you and I need the Word of God in our life. We want to go there for a quick study to understand something as we draw this to a close in a few minutes. Psalm 119, go to verse 9. Psalm 119, verse 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. Now when it says young man, don't just think it's applying to young people. It's applying to everybody of all race, gender, tribes, and classes. It's saying if any man wants to cleanse their way, they want to come back to God. They want to experience. They also want to be able to mourn and plead for God's presence in their life. They want to come back. They want to find their way back to God. They need the Word of God. But notice, how do you study the Word of God? Is that a good question? Lord, how should I study it? Because I read my Bible. How come I'm not getting that response? Are you there? Notice the psalmist tells us why. He says in verse 10, with my what? Number one, he says, when I go to the Bible, I should have nothing else in my heart but Jesus. When I come to worship in the morning, are you listening? When I wake up in the morning and I come to worship, I'm no longer looking at the clock, neither am I checking if I have to get up and do the next work. I'm keeping everything out of my heart as I come to the Word with my whole heart. What does he say next? With my whole heart have I what? With my whole heart have I what? Sought thee. Now, sought is the past tense of seek, yes? Seek ye first the kingdom of God, seek his face and you shall live, seek him with all your heart and all that stuff. But the word sought, the word seek, comes from a deeper Hebrew word, and notice this, the word sought doesn't necessarily mean to go look for someone, the word sought literally means frequency, frequently. More than once, over and over and over and over again. The psalmist is saying, Lord, I don't just come to the Word. I don't just take the Word as my guide, but I keep coming back to the Word. I frequently come to the Word. Is your Bible study time only your morning and evening? Or do you, within the day, always now and then, take a time to frequently refer to the Word and find power? Now notice this. In verse 9 he says, how can a man cleanse his way? He's not just talking about, I'm dirty, Lord, how can I get cleansed and come closer to you? But he's also telling us, how can you stay clean and never get stained? Would you like that? Lord, how can I don't want to get up again and pray for the same. Aren't you tired sometimes praying for the same sin over? I mean, if it's a new sin, at least with some courage I can come to God. God, forgive me, I've never done this before. Forgive me for this. But doesn't it feel embarrassing to keep coming with the same stuff? So the psalmist says, Lord, I want to stay clean. I don't want to get dirty and come back to you. I want to stay clean, and the only way I can do that, Lord, is to frequently come to the Word. I have to frequently seek you again and again and again. Notice verse 11, Psalm 119, verse 11. Thy word have I what? We sang this song. Did we sing this song tonight? Thy word have I what? Hid in my heart. Somebody thinks, wait a second. So I've got to somehow try to hide a few verses in my heart, somehow. Is that? If I can just keep a verse or two hidden. But when you read that word hidden, it means to pile up. It means to store up. It means to collect up and to make a huge heap. Is that? Lord, thy word, I've not just come frequently seeking you, but when I come frequently seeking what I find, I now store up in my heart. I now store up and pile up in my heart. Because friends, listen to me. You read out a text, I don't think this applies to me. That doesn't mean it's not important. You there? Somebody sharing a word, I don't think that applies to me. That doesn't mean it's not important. If the word is presented, take the word, store it up. You might not need it today, but definitely you'll need it tomorrow. You might not be going through that struggle tonight, but you might go through that struggle 2 weeks from now, and you're going to need that word to keep you clean. Lord, thy word have I stored up, have I piled up in my heart, that I might not what? I want to come back to that. Go to verse 13. Psalm 119, verse 13. He says, with my lips have I what? Declared all the judgments of thy mouth. With my lips have I declared. My friends, now when we say declared, we're thinking of preachers. Psalmist is David, used to preach and this and that, but I'm not a declarer. The word declare literally means to recount. What does it mean? To recount. You don't have to mount a pulpit. It says here in verse 13, with my lips have I declared the judgments of thy mouth. You don't have to mount a pulpit to tell and talk about the word of God. It says you've just got to learn to recount God's word to anyone around you. With my lips have I not preached? The psalmist is saying, with my lips have I recounted it. One of the best ways you can minister to anyone is to sit them down, pick up a verse from the Bible, and tell them how real that verse is in your life. Tell them how applicable that verse is in your life. Tell them how that verse saw you through the darkest storm of your life. Recount God's word. Here's the thing. If you've not been living deeply enough with God, if you've not been obeying Him enough every day and coming to Him frequently, there's very few things for you to recount. Are you listening? There are very few things for you to talk about God to anyone. So you can read a text here, you can read a text there, but if someone tells you, tell me what this has done for you, you all of a sudden go quiet. You can reach 10,000 sermons. But if they ask you, tell me what this has done for you in your own life, you go quiet. And friends, unless the word is lived out in my life, it is nothing but theory in my head. It's not real. Unless we've lived out the word in our life, it's not real to us. The psalmist calls us to do that. Notice, as we go on, what he says in verse 10, Psalm 119 and verse 10. Psalm 119, verse 10. Take a look at that. With my whole heart have I what? Sought thee. And we studied the word sought. It means to come frequently to God. Lord, I've been coming again and again and again to you. Because I've been coming again and again, Lord, please do not let me wander from thy commandments. Lord, I've been coming to you again and again, and which is why I plead with you that you may not let me wander. The word wander in the Hebrew has three meanings. How many meanings? Number one. Wander in the Hebrew means to make a mistake. Are you there? Lord, the reason why I'm coming back to the word again and again, the reason why I'm seeking your face, the reason why I'm frequenting your door and frequenting the feet of Jesus, because Lord, I don't want to make a mistake in your presence. There are those who are willfully running away from God. That's a different story. But Lord, I don't even want to make a mistake. Is there a church member here who wants that in their life? Lord, I want to get to a point where I don't even make a mistake. If you want to get there, you've got to memorize Psalm 16 and verse 8. Are you ready? Psalm 16 and verse 8. We've got to be able to pray that when we come to God in prayer. Psalm 16 and verse 8. The Bible says, the psalmist says, I have always kept the Lord before me. Are you listening? I have always kept the Lord before me. Because He is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Did you catch that? I have always kept the Lord before me. Because He's at my right hand, I will not be moved. Now, how many of us tonight here can say, I have always kept the Lord before me? He's always there. And because He's there, I cannot make a mistake. And the psalmist says, Lord, I want to come to you again and again, seek you again and again, because, Lord, I beg you, do not let me even make a mistake. That's meaning number one. Number two, it means to sin through ignorance. Sin through what? Ignorance. Lord, do not let me wander. It means somebody who sins through ignorance. Now, if you're old enough, listen. If you're old enough, maybe what I'm about to say might have happened to someone tonight itself. Maybe someone tonight is saying, I wish I knew this message. Let's say, for instance, about the tithe. I wish somebody would have preached this message to me last year. Don't raise your hand. Maybe somebody here today felt and understood that very clearly. I wish I had known this last year, because all this past year, I was robbing from God in some way or the other. Now that is sinning through ignorance. You just didn't know. The psalmist is begging with the Lord, Lord, I want to come to you, seek your word, stay with you. Not only do I not want to make a mistake, Lord, I also don't want to sink through ignorance. Don't let me do anything, O Lord, that would be a significant manifestation of my ignorance of your word. Lord, I want to know your word. I want it to be in my heart. I want to live out your word. Lord, I don't want to make a mistake. Do not let me make a mistake, Lord. Do not let me sin through ignorance. And lastly, do not let me wander, which means, Lord, do not let me go astray. I don't want to go astray, Lord. I want to stay with you. I want to stay with you. Somebody's got to pray that prayer tonight as you go home. Before you sleep, somebody's got to kneel by their bedside and say, Lord, please help me to come to you frequently because I don't want to make a mistake against you. I don't want to wander. Lord, I don't want to sin through ignorance, so teach me your word. I don't want to walk away from you, Lord. I do not want to go astray. So keep me with you. Keep me with you. Let's go back to 1 Samuel 7 as I close. 1 Samuel chapter 7. As we close our worship this evening. 1 Samuel 7. God's people have walked away from God. And they were busy following gods. What is this? Listen to this foolishness. They were busy worshipping gods that were already defeated by their one true God. Are you there? They were busy worshipping gods that were already defeated by their one true God. Because God had shown them so much. God had shown them so much. And we always complain and we say, and we look down on the Israelites. They were so hard-headed, so stern. Why couldn't they believe in God's promises? Did they forget the Red Sea? Did they forget the manna from heaven? How did they complain for water? Why did they complain for food? And while we look at the Israelites and pass all these remarks, we never look at our life and say, how dare I forget how the Lord saw me through that struggle? How dare I worry? If the Lord saw me through that, will He not see me through this? If He fed me yesterday, will He not feed me today? And the beautiful thing about God is, friends, sometimes, He will not put food on your table. Are you there? Sometimes He will make sure there's no food on your table. Joshua, to teach you that man does not live by bread. So when a door closes in life, it's not time to mourn. It is time to rejoice. Because when your daily sustenance comes to a close, it's not time to be discouraged. It's time to get excited. If this has closed, I wonder what God is about to do next. If this, what I thought is the greatest miracle, if this has closed upon me, I wonder what He's up to next. And if this thing, I let it worry me, how dare I forget what He has done in the past? Forget what He has done in the past. Friends, listen to me as I take you quickly through 1 Samuel 7. Notice this. 1 Samuel 7, verse 7. When the Philistines heard that the children of Israel were gathered together to Mizpah, the lords of the Philistines went up against Israel. When the children of Israel heard, they were afraid of the Philistines. An attack is coming. Some crisis, financial challenge, physical challenge, emotional challenge, family struggle. Some crisis came and the Israelites got afraid. Have you been afraid? Have you been afraid? Mm-hmm. But notice the dichotomy of how we behave today and how the Israelites, who we look down on, how they behaved in verse 8. The children of Israel said to Samuel, cease not to cry unto the Lord our God for us, that He will save us out of the hand of the Samuel. Philistines are coming to attack us. We don't care about an army. We don't want to prepare the soldiers. We don't want to prepare our shields and spears. We just want to pray, because when the attack comes, we want to learn to just worship the Lord. For our God alone is able to save us from this attack. The Philistines are coming. So what? You've got to worship. They're coming to attack. So what? I am in prayer. And I'm going to stay there. Notice this. Verse 9. Samuel took a sucking lamb, offered it for a burnt offering, wholly unto the Lord. Samuel cried to the Lord and said, for Israel, and the Lord heard him. Verse 10. As Samuel was offering, who drew near? Now this is the proper worship. An offering is happening, an animal is being killed, God is being glorified, Israel is singing songs, they're praying, they're fasting, as they're before the Lord. By the way, that's the correct context. If you do not believe me, you can read verse 6 with me. They gathered together to Mizpah, verse 6, 1 Samuel 7, verse 6. They gathered to Mizpah, they drew water, they poured it out before the Lord, and they fasted on that day and said, we have sinned against the Lord. So they were praying, they were fasting, they were acknowledging that, Lord, we've gone away from you. And they said, Lord, this time we will not run to money to find refuge, we'll run to God. We won't go begging for loans and try to invest in this cheap business and that business. We will run to Jesus. He will save us this time, not money and not some business. He will save us. Notice the results. Notice the results. In verse 10, as Samuel was offering, Israel is worshiping. Philistines drew near to battle. But the Lord thundered with a great thunder on that day upon the Philistines. He discomfited them. They were smitten before Israel. And the men of Israel went out of Mizpah, pursued the Philistines, smote them until they came under Bethcar. See, the Bible says, notice carefully, when God's people got too busy in worship that they didn't even care what attack came, God says, I can't believe this. God says, I can't believe that Hiltop Church will stop crying and will stop getting frustrated and angry and discouraged because they've lost some money or some business. But I can't believe that they're busy worshiping when the attack has come. You're there? Amen. The Lord says, I can't believe they're still in prayer. Don't they see the Philistines? They're right there. They're coming near. You see them. But how come they didn't stop prayer and fasting? They're still in prayer. I've got to do something about this. And when God's people got busy worshiping the Lord, the Bible says they didn't have to worry about the enemy, because God said, I'll take care of you. He says, I'll take care of the Philistines. You just keep coming to me frequently. Are you there? You just keep coming to me and keep pleading that you would not wander. You would not lose your way. You would not turn your back on me. You would not sin through ignorance. Keep in the word, I'll take care of you forever. Amen. Friends, when we read Exodus chapter 12, God had told Israel that the day before they pass over and they run out, go there. In fact, let's go to Exodus chapter 12. You've got to see this. It is the passage on Passover. Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12. Are you all there?
Yes.
Notice this very carefully. We're closing now. Exodus chapter 12. It is the night that they take part of the Passover. The next day they're going to be set free. They're going to be set free. Notice, they're going to be set free. And the Lord says, if you want to be set free, you first have to take the lamb. Are you listening? You have to kill the lamb. Put the blood on the doorpost and eat the whole lamb. The lamb has to be in you. But to be separated from Egypt and to walk into freedom, you first have to take the lamb tonight. It was a night like this, a dark night. A dark night might not be on the outside, but a dark night in somebody's soul. And if it's a dark night, he says, you're going to get ready for freedom, but if you want to be free, you have to accept the Lamb Christ Jesus in your life tonight. You want the Philistines to be defeated, you have to accept the Lamb tonight. But notice this, Exodus 12 tells us, verse 33, the Egyptians were urgent upon the people that they might send them out of the land in haste, for they said, we be all dead men. Verse 34, the people took their dough, Israelites now, the Israelites, they took their dough for bread before it was leavened. Are you following? Israel had prepared bread the night before. And they're supposed to add leaven, which is yeast. And yeast makes the bread fluff up. Are you listening? They were supposed to add leaven, but the Bible says they were so busy the night before eating and taking part of the lamb, which is Christ Jesus, that the next day they took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders. They had no time to add leaven to their bread, and they had to quickly run out into freedom. Are you still there? They were so busy with the lamb the night before, they had no time to add leaven to their bread. And Jesus calls leaven sin, because sin puffs you up. Sin fluffs you up and makes you feel like you're a big, mighty, great, holy thing. But the Bible tells us if you're too busy in Jesus, you have no time for leaven in your bread. If you stay occupied in Jesus, if you keep frequenting the Word and keep pleading with the Word, and if you keep hiding and storing and piling this Word, you've got no time to add leaven.
Because if you do, friends, the warning that comes to us in the book Patriarchs and Prophets, page 590. Listen carefully. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 590. The Israelites, as a nation, still continued in a state of irreligion and idolatry. And as a punishment, they remained in subjection to the Philistines. You've got to listen to this. I'm going to read this again. The Israelites as a nation still continued in a state of irreligion and idolatry. As a punishment, they remained in subjection to the Philistines. If you leave this church tonight without surrendering your pride to God, you're going to stay a subject to the Philistines. Is there an attack in your life? Listen carefully. It's going to stay there forever. Is there a curse? It's going to stay there forever until you let go of that idol in your heart. Until you let go of that hatred, that pride, that self-sufficiency, that holier-than-thou attitude, until you let that go. The Lord says, if you keep that as a punishment, you will forever be under the siege of the Philistines. Brothers and sisters, the Lord loves us more than we will ever know. More than we will ever know. Is God good? Yes, but he's better than you will ever come to know. Even in eternity, you'll be tasting the goodness of God. He seeks you, and he seeks you urgently, diligently, wholeheartedly. He wants all of you or none of you. If you're going to give a bit of yourself to him, don't come to him today. He wants all of you or none of you. And that's his prerequisite, that's his desire. We end with an illustration, a true story that happened in the United States. There was a young man who was a soldier out in the battlefield, fighting for his nation.
calls up his mother one day. Son, are you coming home finally? I can't wait to see you, son. Mama, not yet, not yet. I'll call you when it's time. But tell me, when are you coming? I'll let you know, mother. Must have been a conversation. And then another time, he calls again. He says, mother, I said, son, you're about to come. Yes, mom, I'm about to come, but there's a situation. He says, no, don't worry about anything. I can't wait to see you, son. Please come back home as soon as possible. Mother, you see, I'm getting ready to come, but I want to ask you a question. Is it okay if I bring a friend along? Son, it's not even a problem. You can bring your friend along. I just can't wait to see you. Mother, you see, there's been a situation here. Son, I don't care about the situation. I just want to see you. Mother, you see, you don't understand. My friend who I'm bringing home, he's undergone a very rough accident in the war. Son, it doesn't matter. Just come. No, mother, you need to know this. Son, what is it? Please tell me. I just want to see you. Mother, you see, when we were in the war, he was part of an explosion as a result of which he lost one arm. Son, he lost one arm? I'm so sorry. It doesn't matter. Just bring him. No, mama, that's not it. You see, while he was in the war and then through that explosion, he also lost one leg. Lost a leg? Son, I'm so sorry. But it doesn't matter. You see, mama, you don't understand. As a part of the explosion, as a part of the explosion, he lost one arm. He lost a leg. And he cannot see through one eye. So he can't see. Doesn't have an arm. Doesn't have one leg. Now, son, I don't mind. You can really bring him, but you know your mother's old, and I might struggle. I might struggle to take care of him. If you're willing to help out, and take care of him, you can gladly bring him around. And the son said, Mother, thank you. Thank you. I just want to do that. So, son, when are you coming, Mom? I'll call you. Keeps the phone. The mother is excited, expecting the son to come. And the son just says, Mom, I'll call you and keep the phone. But the mother is excited. And the next day, a knock on the door early in the morning, a knock on the door. The neighbor is at the door. As she opens the door, the neighbor is standing there, a beautiful young lady. As she stands there, opening the newspaper, and she points the mother to the headlines. She points the mother to the headlines, shows a picture, and says, you've got to leave. He said, no, I've got no time. I'm preparing the house. My son is supposed to come. He said, he's going to call me. He's supposed to come. He says, no, you've got to read this. You've got to read this. And she takes her attention to the newspaper and makes her read the article. The article talks about a war veteran who had just returned from the war, and then the story went on to show a picture of a wheelchair floating in a lake with a body right next to it. And the story read that this was a war veteran returning from home who tried to kill himself. The story went on to say that when the man was checked into, he had no arm, he had no leg, and could not see. As the mother read this, she kept reading. She said, this is exactly the guy my son was talking about. And as she kept reading, she read the name, and it was the name of her own son. True story. She reads this and she's panicked. She's like, my son was talking about himself. Why didn't he tell me he was talking about himself? Why didn't he tell me I would have done anything? But then she remembered, I told him, if you can take care of him, then it's okay, but I can't take care of him. And then she looks at the neighbor, but the neighbor tells us, hey, there's hope. they said that they rushed him to the nearby hospital. She said, do you know the hospital? Let's go there right now. So the two women rushing to the hospital, the mother so anxious to know whether the son is still alive or he has passed away, runs to the hospital. The reception says he's in one room. They run to the room. The mother brushes through the door, pushes everyone aside, sees the son on the bed, and her heart is elated to see that the son is still alive. She runs in and falls on the son's chest and embraces him and cries and cries and cries and cries and says, son, why didn't you tell me? Mom, look at me. I've lost an arm. I have no leg. I can't see. What good am I doing? What are you talking about? No, no, Mom, look at me. Look at me. What am I? I'm a cripple. What benefit would I be to you? The mother went with eyes filled with tears and with a very heavy heart. She says, son, it does not matter. Listen carefully. She says, son, it does not matter. I'll take what's left. I'll take whatever is left of you. One arm, one leg, no eyes. It's okay. I'll take what's left of you. I'll take what's left of you. Brothers and sisters, there are many seated here, crippled. You've lost a spiritual arm. You've lost a spiritual leg. You can't see spiritually anymore. Your Father in heaven says, I'll take what's left. Your Father in heaven says to you, I'll take what's left. You've got a little faith, I'll take it. You've got a little bit of desire to seek me, I'll take it. I'll take whatever you have left. You have a little bit of desire, hey, just come, pray, I'll take what's left. You've got a little bit of energy left, you've got a few more years you think you have to live, I'll take whatever you have left, but don't leave me. Don't turn your back on me. Come to me as crippled as you may be, as broken as you may be. I'll take whatever is left and make the best out of it. I'll take whatever you've got to offer me and I'll turn it into the best you can never imagine. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed as we close this worship service. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed, every head bowed and every eye closed. Do you have anything left tonight? You stopped reading the Word. You're not coming to Him frequently. Your prayer life is next to dead. Do you still have something left? Do you still have maybe a little bit of desire left? The Lord says, I'll take it. I'll take it. Is there some past experience that haunts you? He says, yeah, give it to me. I'll take it. I'll take it. Many of us have forgotten that we were not supposed to carry our burdens. We're only supposed to carry the cross because our burdens were lifted in Calvary. Brothers and sisters, what do you have left tonight to give to Jesus? I urge you, plead with you tonight, beg with you, give it to Him before you have nothing left. Give to Him what little you have left. Before you have nothing left to give to Him. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Is there somebody who wants to cry to God and say, Lord, I do not want to wander. I do not want to make a mistake. Lord, I do not want to sin through ignorance. Help me, Lord. Help me tonight. Save me, Lord. Please take whatever is left of me before I have nothing left in me. God,
Please help me. If that is you, your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed, will you just come to the front as we pray together? Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. You don't have to look at anyone. You are a cripple, not anyone else. You feel crippled today. You feel like you've lost an arm. You feel like you've lost a leg. You feel like soon you'll have nothing left. If you feel like there is very little time left, and you feel like I want to give to God whatever little I have left, Lord, I want to come and give this to you. Lord, I want to come and give this to you. If you come to the front, you're not coming for the preacher. You're just coming to signify that I want to move away from my crippled nature. I want to move away from my past. I want to move away from where I am and give to the Lord whatever I'm going through. Whoever you are, whatever condition you may be in, you want to give to the Lord whatever disturbs you, whatever haunts you, whatever robs you of your peace. You want to give to the Lord whatever you have left tonight. That is you. Just come to the front as we pray together and give it all into the hands of God. Lord, help me not to wander. Teach me, Lord. Instruct me, Lord. And take all of me, not a little bit of me. If that is you, you're coming to the front, let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much. Thank you, O Lord, for you don't treat us the way we deserve. You treat us the way you want us to be. You treat us like your children. And even when we've sinned, the Bible tells us when we've been unfaithful, you have been faithful. When we've turned our backs, Lord, you've not changed. You've consistently pursued us with everlasting love. I thank you, Lord, for your sons and daughters. Lord, we see, O God, that we don't respond like Isaiah. We don't tremble like Habakkuk in your presence because we're too far away from you, Father. Lord, pull us nearer and show us the ugliness of our sin. Draw us nigh, Lord, that we may see how filthy we are deep within. We feel we're too righteous. We feel, O God, that we're doing great things for the church. Lord, we're not close. We're not close is why we feel so good about ourselves. Lord, we are nothing without you. Please draw us nearer to you. Please pull us nearer to you. Please, O Father, we are crippled tonight. Crippled in tight pain. Crippled in faith. Crippled in worship. Crippled in the study of God's word. Crippled in our prayer life. Crippled in our relationship with you. Will you please take what is left of us, Lord, before there is nothing left? Please, mighty God, pick us up from where we are tonight. Change us, transform us, rebuke us. Discipline us, Lord. Put us on the path of righteousness. And save us. Save our homes. Save the children in the homes, Lord. Save our parents, save our loved ones, uncles, aunts who walked away. Father, humble husbands and wives, unite them in the love of God. Save your people, Father. Please save Hiltop Church. That the ark of God, the glory of God will not just remain in Hiltop. It will go with all these people as they go home. May every member of this church carry the glory of God in their life back into their houses and shine for the glory of God. Father, may you please be glorified, be magnified, be uplifted in all these lives. We praise you. We give you glory. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.